I'm Allison Berman. We're here live at the Global Summit. I'm with Anita Schjøll Breda. Anita is the CEO and co-founder of Iris.AI. It's a startup that Fast Company recently named one of the most innovative artificial intelligence startups of 2017. She's recently also been named faculty at Singularity University Denmark, and she's an alumni of the 2015 Graduate Solutions Program. Welcome. Yes,
thank you.
Okay, so let's talk about Iris.AI. It's been so exciting following the growth of the company. Tell me about a bit about the application of the AI system.
Right, so our ultimate goal is to build an AI researcher. And we're kind of the core belief that if one human being could sit down and read every single research paper, every single patent in the world, just read them all in one go, connect the dots, we'd be able to solve a lot of problems. You know, we have a lot of knowledge, it's just inaccessible. So ultimately what we're doing is building an AI that can read and understand and connect the dots in all of it for us. But obviously zooming that back into today, which is what really matters, right? What is it that we're building now is a tool for R&D, research institutes, entrepreneurs with kind of big hairy problems to solve where you need to apply research and science to solve it. And we're semi-automating the process of mapping out what you should read to solve the problem or to see what research you need to do to solve the problem. So it's basically you start with a problem statement, take that problem statement, give it to the tool to read. You can write out in your own words.
You can copy and paste it or write it into the system.
Exactly. So in your own words, what is the problem you're trying to solve? Give that to the system to read, and we map out in a visual format what research is relevant to the challenge that you're solving.
It's amazing. And so Iris.AI in many ways is about transparency of research. And so right now in technology, sometimes there's tension of technology and transparency. Sometimes it feels like oil and water. Other times with open source trends, it feels very homogenous. So what are your thoughts on transparency and technology?
So I think, I mean, we're in an interesting spot, right? Because we're both in the kind of the tech where you talk about open source and do you keep things a trade secret? Do you patent your software or do you publish all the code, right? And then we're also operating in the science field where paywall content and open access research papers are kind of in the same kind of, what do you do, right? Do you pay to publish it openly so that anyone can access it? And we very much fall on the side of openness and transparency. We're firm believers in that, especially when it comes to science. We believe that it should be open, it should be publicly available, especially the science that has been paid for by our tax money should be openly and freely available. Now, we are not in a position right now to do much about that, but the least we can do and what we're working on is making sure that you can at least find the right research, you know? And then we'll see, you know, the open access movement is flourishing. More and more papers are published open access. Then you have, you know, archive and everything that's being kind of pre-published there. So you have this movement of openness, especially in areas of exponential tech, where there is just more and more openness. So we're firm believers of that. We think that if we want to get humanity, you know, to the next level, we have to, as we say, and sorry for swearing, science the shit out of it. And you know, if you want to do that, you have to have it openly. You know, it doesn't help to have lots of knowledge if it's all hidden behind paywalls.
Completely. And so this open access, was this part of the inspiration of founding Iris.AI?
So there was a number of things. I mean, we sat down and looked at the 10 to the 9th challenge, like how can we positively impact the world? And we looked at, you know, we ended up stumbling into the kind of the academic publishing industry and looked at it from a number of different angles, right? There's so many things that are problematic with it. You know, paywall content is one of them. The system for scoring points when you publish papers is one of them. So like, it's better to split up a research project in two papers rather than publish it all in one because you'll score more points. There's just a number of things. The citation system is one of the things where we saw that, you know, most existing tools to navigate the research world or search engines, if you like, is based on the citation system that has some merit. But when it comes to finding solutions to your problems, that, you know, the citation system works more as a popularity index, and I know that's simplifying it, but you know, so we just believe that, you know, there's a number of issues with the whole industry, and open access was one of the trends that we saw, and we're like, okay, well, as more and more research is becoming open, how do we find it, right?
Yeah, and so is there an example of positive impact that the system has been able to make, or just an interesting use case that you love talking about?
So we have a couple. So one of them, which is very much tied to the industry. So we're focusing in on material science to start with. It's just a good field to begin with. It's cross-disciplinary by nature. One of the challenges we've worked on with one of our partners is, can you build a reusable rocket out of composite materials, right? Mm-hmm. And this is one of the ways we proved that the tool worked. We had multiple teams compete against each other to solve that challenge. Can we do that? Mm-hmm. And one of the teams was using an old school search engine. Their conclusion at the end of 5 hours was, nope, we can't do this. Technology isn't there. The team that used our tool, they concluded it was possible. They outlined three key papers on how it could be done, and said it was going to be really expensive, but it was possible. So that was very exciting.
It's exciting to see how artificial intelligence systems can extend human intelligence.
Definitely.
And I think so. I want to ask you, zooming out, looking at the industry and the technology of artificial intelligence, in many ways it's under heat, hype and heat.
Very much so.
What kind of responsibility do you think AI researchers, people developing it, have to ensure they're making systems that are going to propel humanity forward for the better? Because we see these news headlines that feel extremely dystopian.
Yes.
What are your thoughts?
So I think it's important to kind of see the big difference between like 25 plus years into the future and like zooming back into today, which is always, and you see a lot of startups that have these like, and we do the same, right? We have this big vision, we're going to build an AI researcher, but that is still 10 years into the future, right? So what are we doing today? And I think it's the same when it comes to the ethical responsibility. You know, sure, we can have the discussions on like utopia, dystopia, you know, are we building Skynet, which is the simplified version of it. And I think that is too much of a, you know, hype headline that is really easy to latch onto. I think the more pressing issues is already today, like what data sets are you using to build your algorithms, right? And you have a ton of examples on like beauty pageants online, right, which uses all pictures of white women, white skinny women to judge beauty, right? And then so if anyone who doesn't look like that uploads their picture to see if they're beautiful, they're not, right? Because the data set you picked isn't the right one. You have a police department in Florida that, you know, did racial profiling in their in their algorithm to, you know, to assess. So I think that's, you know, today that is where, you know, a lot of the responsibility lies. Like, what data are we using? Mm-hmm. How are we making sure that we don't build in our own biases into the system? And I'm far more concerned about that. As more and more automated systems comes into our everyday lives, how do we make sure that we don't, you know, because we are living in a society that is incredibly discriminating against a number of different minorities. Mm-hmm. How can we make sure that we don't build that into our systems? Because then suddenly also we remove ourselves. Mm-hmm. It wasn't me, it was a computer system, right?
I didn't do it.
But we do, because we build it into our systems.
Right? It's amazing hearing that in your methodology, because, you know, we saw the huge article that came out, artificial intelligence has a white guy problem, about how it's being built. So it's critical to be addressing it now.
Yep.
So with Iris.AI, right now it works in tandem with someone inputting a question. Do you one day see Iris.AI totally autonomous as just a machine not working in collaboration with a human?
So more and more so. But I think, I mean, so today it's very much in collaboration. It's an iterative process going from a problem statement, zooming out to find a bunch of research. Next steps that we're launching this fall is focusing back in to figure out, the geeky term is a semi-automation of the systematic landscape mapping. But anyway, it's focusing in, and that's very much an iterative process, right? And Iris makes some assumptions, asks the users about the assumptions, and we build it together. If you look further into the future, there's going to be more and more autonomy, right? Iris can extract a hypothesis from a paper, see all of the hypotheses in connection in a similarity graph, build new hypotheses on the top of existing, and then actually go test them in a simulation environment or robotic lab. And at that point, you're looking at more autonomy.
Right.
But, you know, so yes, but on the other hand, it will never, you know, never say never, but like our goal isn't to like press play and then Iris solves all of the problems in the world. Like, humanity in the world is complex, right? Mm-hmm. And I think we always are going to need some level of human involvement. Although that we have this, if we talk way beyond what we give as a standard pitch, you know, when Iris is able to figure out science and you know, find science, find the right theories, you know, extract the hypothesis, etc., we can actually connect Iris to other AIs and teach them science. And at that point, we're starting to see less and less, you know, human involvement. So as with anything, right now it requires a lot of manual time. The next version will reduce the manual labor with about 90% for that part of the process. So yes, we do fall into the category of tools that reduce labor time.
Yeah. When you talk about Iris AI being able to one day speak with other AI systems, I get the her image where Samantha starts communicating with all the other systems.
Right. I don't think Iris will ever be like friendly and pleasant. It's a researcher, you know. know, get the job done.
What questions are hot on your mind about AI research or AI in general?
Right now, it's about the hype, right? It's like, are we doing ourselves, and it's a personal question too, right? So we started the company 2 years ago, and we present ourselves as an AI company, right? Iris.AI, like it's in our domain and our name. So the question is, are we doing ourselves and the world a disservice by like positioning everything as AI, right? It's like AI for dog walking, right? AI for this, AI for that. And we're like, are we hyping it too much so that we end up overhyping it? Because people are very excited about AI these days, and I get that. And there's plenty of things we can do that are super exciting. But then there's also the fact that like, we're not quite there yet, right? There's still a lot of development. We can do the little things really well, but like the big vision, the crazy future is still years away, right?
Yeah.
So I think that's one of my concerns, that we're overhyping it. And I've, you know, started more and more, you know, stop talking about us as an AI company only, but like, we're a company that solves important problems for R&D.
Yeah, and you guys just won here the Global Grand Challenge for Learning. Congratulations.
Thank you. That's very exciting.
And I can see how you are a learning organization as well, and so that would be one way also to position the platform.
Yeah, exactly. And we do fall into the learning ed tech space, obviously, with people who are, you know, not necessarily highly educated. One of the effects, actually, that we're seeing from our platform is that it does, to a certain degree, de-skill the users or the requirements on the user. Like, you don't need to be a professor to, you know, map out the science. As in some instances, if you do this manually, you have to have kind of at least an associate professor degree or level to be able to do the full rigorous manual process. While with our tool, we de-skill it. But still, we're not, you know, we're not a kindergarten tool. You do need to know a little bit about science or research or the field you're working in.
But it's exciting. Imagine a teacher putting it to work with their class on their research. I remember when we were in school going through encyclopedia pages and how much it slowed things down.
Yeah.
So you are a female founder. There's also a bunch of hype, misconceptions, stories about this experience. What have been any misconceptions that you have encountered as a female founder?
You know, I think for me, the thing that kind of messes with my head is like, I don't think of myself as like a female founder.
Yeah.
Like, I'm a founder. I have a company to run. I have technology to build. We have a product to sell. Like, my day-to-day life isn't about being female. My day-to-day life is about running a startup company and succeeding. And so that's why it's always like, whenever I'm like, oh, like, you know, I won an award for like, you know, inspiring 50 women in tech. And I'm like, oh, right, I'm a woman in tech. Like, right, I forgot about that. Right? I think it's, we don't go around thinking about the fact that like our bodies or our genetics are the way, like it just is, right? I just happen to be female. And so for me, that's the biggest misconception. Like, this is not something that's on my mind. While having, of course, been in situations where, like, I've gotten the, like, older male engineer, like, patting me on the head and laughing
like,
at me.
Thank
as
you.
I'm like, you know. Yes, I've been there, but that's not my day-to-day business.
Yeah, and it's not stopping your game either. You are...
No, and of course, and it is sad to see, like, what's going on in Silicon Valley. And then,
completely.
And, like, the limited amount of female partners I meet and the VCs I pitch to. And of course, there is the question in the back of my head, like, am I being, you know, judged unfairly? Because again, when we talked about the biases in our algorithms, it's the same thing. And we're not aware of our biases, right? So there is this little voice every now and then that goes like, is this affecting our fundraising? Should I put one of my male co-founders? Like, probably not, because like I am the CEO of this company. That's who they want to see.
Yeah.
Still, like, there's always the question, like, is this impacting our fundraising? On the other hand, again, I have a company to run.
Yeah. And so what is fueling you often with pushing all your work forward personally and with Iris.AI?
It's a good question. I just really like what I do. Like, I have a lot of energy. I have a lot of passion. I just really want to make something that matters. You know, I love seeing like examples of our technology put to good use. We have another, I mentioned earlier, we had a couple of different case studies that I really like. Another one is this tiny little chocolate factory, West Coast US, who's like, he wanted to build a sustainable product line, right? New product line, sustainable, healthier chocolate. And he's like, but I don't have an R&D department, you know? And he stumbled across our tool and used that to build a new product line. And he was like basically R&D enabling himself, not being highly skilled, not being a researcher, but
not having tons of resources.
Exactly, but using our free tool that is available on our website to do an R&D process, you know, and basically R&D enabling himself. And things like that really gets me going, where I'm like, we're doing something that actually matters to people, that people are excited about. So that's kind of what keeps me going. And then, I don't know, I've never had a real job, you know, I don't know what that is. I don't know what it looks like. I'm just really enjoying the freedom and flexibility and hard work and, like, seeing things grow from literally nothing and then seeing what we've built.